Hi, I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and I make mental health education videos. Today, I'm talking about intermittent fasting and how it has an antidepressant effect. In my video on magnesium, I talk about how BDNF is like fertilizer for the brain. BDNF stands for brain-derived neurotrophic factor, and it's low in people who are depressed. BDNF stimulates growth of your nerve cells in your hippocampus and other brain regions. And new cell growth is the mechanism behind brain plasticity. You want your brain to be as plastic or flexible as possible. That is, you want to be able to form new cell connections that help you adapt to changes in your environment. And BDNF makes that happen. BDNF also increases serotonin. So when you're depressed, you have lower levels of BDNF. Antidepressant medications increase BDNF, and so does extended fasting. Fasting increases ketones, which trigger BDNF production. Also, extended fasting increases ghrelin, which is the hunger hormone. And increased ghrelin improves depression through the chemical orexin. That's a very simplified overview of the biochemistry behind fasting and improved mood and brain health. I have references in the description if you want to dive deeper into the chemistry. There are many ways that you can intermittently fast. Some people choose to fast for a whole day, once a week, or they alternate days. The more common way to do this is to limit your eating window. And what does that mean? Let's say you have a 9-to-5 job and you wake up at 7 a.m., you have breakfast around 7:30, and then you leave for work at 8. You get home around 6 and have dinner around 7. In this scenario, your eating window is 7:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m., assuming it takes you 30 minutes to eat. You have a 12-hour eating window and a 12-hour fasting window. If you sip a glass of wine on the couch to wind down until 9:30, you've extended your eating window to 14 hours and your fasting window is 10 hours. Now you may say, wine is not food. It's not solid food, but it's carbs. And to your body, carbs is food no matter where it came from. And this is probably the pattern of many people to have this long period where you're eating food. An ideal fasting window to get this effect of the increased BDNF is about 16 to 18 hours for your window, your fasting window. A 16-hour window means 8 hours of eating, and then 6 hours of eating for an 18-hour fasting window. And these are ideal windows, but you need to build up to it. So the first step is to look at your schedule and figure out what your normal eating window is. To go back to my 9-to-5 example, my eating window without the evening wine is 12 hours. Step two is to establish your new window. You want to add an hour or two to your fasting window and then maybe increase it weekly. You could even start slower by applying the new window to just a few days a week. So my step two is to increase my window to 14 hours. Step three is to assign times to your new window. I think the easiest way to do this is to push back your breakfast. Notice I didn't say skip breakfast. You just want to push it back later. If you push back your breakfast, you get to take advantage of your sleeping window hours towards your fast. And that's what we normally do. To do this, you would start with when you finish your last meal and then count ahead 14 hours or whatever your window, your fasting window is going to be. You may prefer to keep your breakfast the same and have your last dinner earlier. The disadvantage of this is that it may mean having dinner at work, and then you have a longer time in the late afternoon and evening that you're awake and not eating. If you live with other people who aren't following the plan, you have to watch them eat dinner while you fast. In my 9-to-5 work example, to extend the fast to 14 hours and have dinner at 7, I would not have any carbs after dinner, and then I would have breakfast at 9:30 a.m. Since I would already be at work at that time, I'll have to take my breakfast and eat it at work. If that's inconvenient because I'm seeing patients at 9:30, I can try and move up my dinner to 6 p.m. and then eat while I'm driving around 8:30. This brings up the issue of who this might not work well for. This gets nitpicky and very detailed, and being on a strict schedule like this with precise timing may not work very well for a person with OCD or ADHD. Also, the attention to detail that this requires may stir up a person's eating disorder. You want to be generous with drinking water when you're fasting. You can drink coffee or tea without sugar, but make sure you also drink water to offset the dehydrating effects of the coffee and tea. What I described is not as drastic of a change as 24-hour fasting. Establishing these windows condenses the time that you eat, so you're not grazing on food for all of your waking hours. You eat while you're expending energy, then you stop, you sleep, and you rest your mind and body, and then you break the fast and eat again. It's important to realize that intermittent fasting is not a diet, it's a schedule adjustment. When you eat, you still need to make healthy choices about the foods that you eat during your window. Some people will try and go all in with a very short eating window for which they think will get the maximum results, and when they get to their window, they stuff down massive amounts of unhealthy food because one, they're starving, and two, they feel like they've earned it. If you do this, the inflammation created by the unhealthy food offsets any gains from the extended fasting. Watch this video that I did talking about gut health, and then this one on magnesium for depression and anxiety. Thanks for watching. See you next time.